The Father's voice was heard. This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul is longing and yearning for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out to the living God. In a resplendent cloud the Holy Spirit appeared. The Father's voice was heard. This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him.
Sisters, sometimes we have a feast or solemnity that falls on a Sunday during ordinary time, and this is one of those Sundays, as August 6th is the Transfiguration of the Lord. So as we celebrate the Transfiguration of Christ, we first call to mind our sins so we can prepare ourselves for these sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you are mighty God and Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, you feed us with your body and your blood. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King. O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who in the glorious transfiguration of your only begotten Son, confirmed the mysteries of faith by the witness of the fathers, and wonderfully prefigured our full adoption to sonship, grant, we pray, to your servants, that listening to the voice of your beloved Son, we may merit to be co-heirs with him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Daniel. As I watched, thrones were set up, and the Ancient One took his throne. His clothing was snow bright, and the hair on his head as white as wool. His throne was flames of fire, with wheels of burning fire. A surging stream of fire flowed out from where he sat. Thousands upon thousands were ministering to him, and myriads upon myriads attended him. The court was convened, and the books were opened. As the visions during the night continue, I saw one like a son of man coming on the clouds of heaven. When he reached the Ancient One and was presented before him, the one like a son of man received dominion, glory, and kingship. All peoples, nations, and languages serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not be taken away. His kingship shall not be destroyed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
No. is King, the Most High over all the earth. The Lord is King. The Lord is King, the Most High over all the earth. The Lord is King. The Lord is King. Let the earth rejoice. Let the many islands be glad. Clouds and darkness surround him. Justice and right are the foundations of his throne. The Lord is King, the Most High over all the earth. The Lord is King. The mountains melt like wax before the face of the Lord. Before the face of the Lord of all the earth, the skies proclaim his justice. All people see his glory. The Lord is King, the Most High over all the earth. The Lord is King. For you in the deed of the Lord, Most High above the all the earth, exalted far above all gods, exalted far above all gods. The Lord is King, the Most High over all the earth. The Lord is King.
A reading from the second letter of Saint Peter. Beloved, we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we had been eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when that unique declaration came to him from the majestic glory. This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased. We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. Moreover, we possess the prophetic message that is altogether reliable. You will do well to be attentive to it, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased, listen to him. Alleluia.
With you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus took Peter, James, and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, conversing with him. Then Peter said to Jesus in reply, "Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud cast a shadow over them. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell prostrate and were very much afraid. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Rise, and do not be afraid." And when the disciples raised their eyes, they saw no one else but Jesus alone. As they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, "Do not tell the vision to anyone until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord. Well, as we celebrate this beautiful feast, the Transfiguration, like any of our great feasts, there's so many elements, so many beautiful things that we could touch on and reflect on today. But the first thing is that Jesus and the three apostles are going up the mountain to pray, as Jesus often did. So to understand that Jesus being transfigured begins with him going into prayer with the Father. And as he takes these three up the mountain with him, of course, we see this great, what we call a theophany, which is that insight into God, that vision of God, that experience of God that the three apostles were able to see. And it was also ultimately a Trinitarian theophany because of the fact of we have, you know, the three persons all showing up. Obviously, the Father, the voice that comes from the Father, we hear the Father. Jesus is obviously present there. And then the cloud that comes points to the Holy Spirit. And so, of course, this parallels very closely to the theophany that took place at the beginning of Jesus' public ministry with his baptism. Because we hear the Father say very similar words, although in this case adding the words, "Listen to him," at the end, after saying that this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. And in the baptism, of course, the dove was the representation of the Spirit. Here, the cloud represents the Holy Spirit. But it's a it's a beautiful parallel passage. And in fact, the Catechism points this out in section 556. And it says that on the threshold of Jesus' public life, there was his baptism. And then on the threshold of his Passover, that is his death and ultimate resurrection, there was the Transfiguration. So the Transfiguration takes place in Matthew's Gospel after Jesus has started to predict that he is going to suffer, that he's going to die on the cross, but of course before he actually goes through it. And so it's a sign to these three apostles who will also be with Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, in Jesus' greatest hour of suffering, that they also now get to experience the Transfiguration, Jesus in glory. And so the Catechism then connects it to our own spiritual lives by saying that Jesus was baptized to show how we would be baptized, and this would be our first regeneration. This would be our first recreation through the gift of our baptism. And so we see that with Jesus and his baptism as a reflection of that. Well, the Transfiguration then is also a reflection of us and how we are being prepared to be glorified by the Lord as well. But the Transfiguration, like our own lives, is something that we're not quite at that point yet. And so the transfiguration parallels the sacraments in many ways, because the sacraments are glorious encounters with the risen Jesus. We get to experience the person of Jesus in the sacraments that he gave to us. And yet, like the Transfiguration, it wasn't the end of the story, because they had to go back down the mountain, and Jesus had to suffer and he had to die before he was actually going to be resurrected. So it is for us. We get to experience the sacraments. We get to have these great encounters with the Lord Jesus, but we still have to leave this place. We still have to go from the sacraments and enter into the world and enter into a life which will include difficulty and suffering and purification and ultimately death to ourselves, as well as physical death, before we can reach that glorified place with Jesus where we too will be resurrected. And so the Transfiguration is a beautiful image for us in our lives of how we get to experience the Lord, but yet not quite in that perfect way that we are yet glorified with the Lord. And so, in other words, the job is not yet finished, but we get to experience the goodness of God through him, and especially through his sacraments. Now, this also calls to mind for us a special reality that we get to experience through the liturgy and through the sacraments. The Greek word is anamnesis, or also pronounced anamnesis, depending on what theologian you talk to, but it's a Greek word that means memorial or remembrance. And this is what we come to do in the liturgy, is to remember, to have a memorial of what Jesus did for us. This is the word that Jesus uses, of course, at the what we call the institution narrative, when he says, "Do this in remembrance of me," or "Do this in memory of me." And so that's what we gather to do when we celebrate the liturgy, especially as we gather for a Holy Eucharist, is that we are coming to have that memorial. Now, what's important to remember is, again, when we think of that idea of memorial, we just tend to think of something that happened in the past, but it's much more than that. It's not simply that we're remembering a past event. It's not like a reenactment. It's not like a Civil War reenactment where we kind of, or go to Williamsburg or somewhere like that, where it's, okay, we're going to go back in time and kind of pretend we were there and think about what it was like to be there. No, we're actually recognizing that because it's God involved, in fact, God who is outside of time, that, in fact, we're entering into that experience here today. It's becoming present to us again today. Now, unlike Protestants who might accuse us of, again, re-sacrificing Christ at the Mass or something like that. No, we're not re-sacrificing Christ. We're entering into that one perfect sacrifice here again today. For the God who is outside of space and time comes again into space and time here in our very person, and especially on the altar here today. So this anamnesis comes to us, like most things, from our Jewish brothers and sisters who understood this reality in terms of the gift of the Passover. That every time they celebrated the Passover, right, again, they weren't just remembering what happened in the Exodus. They were, in fact, entering into, again, the fact that God was with them no matter where they were in their own lives. And that Passover meal was a calling upon God to be with them in that present moment. So I came across some beautiful commentaries that talked about this concept of anamnesis and what it does for us. It forms an identity in us. It makes us who we are. It makes us true Christians. It makes us followers of the Lord. It gives us our identity by this sacred remembering, by this memorial. It also makes us into a community. That's why we gather as a community. That's why we gather as church. It's forming us not only individually, but collectively as the community of God's people who are calling upon the kingdom of God among us. It also establishes a continuity. That is, we are connected to all those who have celebrated this sacred liturgy throughout the centuries. We're connected to, if we've been Catholic and our families have been Catholic for a while, of course, we're connected to our parents and our grandparents and our great-grandparents who are part of the celebration of Mass. But also we're connected to, all those thousands of years, those 2,000 years of Christians who gathered to celebrate the Eucharist. From the earliest days of the apostles to today, we gather to do what they did. And so there's that continuity throughout time, throughout history, of what we are doing with those holy men and women, those saints who are now in heaven. This liturgy is also helping to form our character. It's teaching us about the kind of people that we are meant to be. By reflecting on the life of Christ and what Christ has done for us, we are supposed to be formed into a people of knowing how to act when we go into the world. And it also then determines our conduct. Again, similarly, it's pointing us to the fact of how it is we're now going to live in our day-to-day life. Again, this is what the liturgy is meant to do for us, but we know as human beings, we sometimes get distracted or sometimes we kind of go through the motions of things. So the danger is that we don't enter into these realities, but it's important for us to enter into that sacred remembrance, that memorial, because we do forget, we do get distracted. So it's why we do need to come to liturgy and come to Mass each Sunday to continue to know and be in front of the Lord that he can strengthen and transform that relationship that he first formed in us through the gift of baptism and now is meant to be strengthened in our other life of faith. So what does this ultimately lead to? Again, another beautiful article said, well, when we really enter into this anamnesis, this sacred remembering, this memorial, we really try and let the Lord change our lives and change our hearts, what should it lead to? Well, it should lead to a sense of rejoicing at what all the Lord has done for us. It should lead to a sense of repentance, to recognize, boy, I haven't lived up to what God has called me to be and called me to do in my life, so we turn in repentance. It should lead us to a deeper understanding of what God is doing in my life and what he wants of me in my daily life. And it should also produce hope for the future. Again, to know that there will be struggle and difficulty and suffering in our daily lives, and yet we are called to have hope because we know of where we are headed. We know that if we are faithful to what Jesus is calling us to, we are meant for glorification. We are meant to be in glory with the Lord, who will change us, who will transform us, who will bring us into his heavenly kingdom. And aren't these realities really what St. Peter is talking about in the second reading today? We hear from that second letter of Peter where he's recounting a little bit about, you know, this experience of being with Jesus on Mount Tabor, right? That we heard this voice from heaven on the holy mountain, he says. And we profess this prophetic message which is reliable. Again, we experience this thing so that we could tell others and so that we could be witnesses to what Jesus did in our own lives and that we can show others what Jesus can do in their lives as well. And so he goes on to say, right, we need to be attentive to it like a lamp shining in a dark place until day dawns and the morning star rises in our hearts. What a beautiful image that is, to recognize that in the midst of our darkness and our suffering that we do experience, the Lord is going to come and rise among us, that his light will continue to shine among us in the midst of our darkness. So as we gather today, we get to practice this great anamnesis, this great remembrance, this great memorial of all that the Lord does for us. Especially, we have this part of the Mass that we call the anamnesis, and that is right after we pray the mystery of faith during the Eucharistic prayer. That next section of the Eucharistic prayer is called the anamnesis, where we recall the things, the basic gospel message of what Jesus has done for us. So you can be attentive to that whenever you hear it today at Mass. But we recognize that we're called to cherish and remember all that Jesus has done for us as we gather for liturgy today. To recognize he gave us the Mass and he gave us the scriptures, the word of God, so that we can continue to be strengthened in our walk with him, so we can to continue to know that he is with us and continue to grow closer to him. So let's cherish the words that we heard in our readings today, where we got to hear from God himself speaking beautiful words, not just thousands of years ago, but also to us today. We get to hear those beautiful words that the Father says to Jesus, and that we are meant to take to heart. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. And we're called to reflect on those beautiful words that Jesus says to the three apostles, and wants also to say to us today, rise and do not be afraid. Now today we remember all that the Lord has done for us as we pray our creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now, gathering together our prayers and our petitions, we entrust all things to our merciful God.
Please respond, Lord, hear our prayer. For the Holy Father, the vigor of Christ, may God continue to bless him with wisdom and strength in leading the church. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For an increase in vocations, may God call forth priests, deacons, sisters, and brothers in service to his people. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For leaders of nations, may God reveal his power, inspiring them in humble service to him and to the people in their care. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who wrestle with doubt, may the Father reveal the love of Christ and draw them home. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all gathered here, may God in his kindness enable us to hear and obey his voice. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially Jean Ireland, Florence Munsick, George Myers, Mary Bereznek, Larry Toth, and Michael Kelly, may they enjoy eternal life in heaven and behold the face of God. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of our parish for whom this Mass is offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Draw near to your servants, O Lord, and answer their prayers with unceasing kindness, that for those who glory in you as their creator and guide, you may restore what you have created and keep safe what you have restored. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The second collection is for maintenance.
You have crowned him with glory and honor, and you have established him above the works of your hands, O Lord. Tis good, Lord, to be here. Your glory fills the night. Your face and garments like the sun shine with unborrowed light. Tis good, Lord, to be here. Your beauty to behold, where Moses and Elijah stand, your messengers of old, fulfiller of the past, promise of things to be. We hail your body glorified and our redemption seen. Before we taste of death, we see your kingdom come. Before us, keep your vision bright and make this place our home. 'Tis good, Lord, to be here, yet we may not remain. But since you bid us leave the mount, come with us to the plains.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Sanctify, O Lord, we pray, these offerings here made to celebrate the glorious transfiguration of your only begotten Son, and by his radiant splendor, cleanse us from the stains of sin. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he revealed his glory in the presence of chosen witnesses, and filled with the greatest splendor that bodily form which he shares with all humanity, that the scandal of the cross might be removed from the hearts of his disciples, that he might show how in the body of the whole church is to be fulfilled what so wonderfully shone forth first in its head. And so with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty without end, we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, By the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. You have set us free.
Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saints Peter, James, and John, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and David our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people that you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you, and your compassionate, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven." Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your
spirit. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Grant us
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
When Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. The Lord is King, let earth rejoice, let the many islands be glad. cloud and darkness surround him. Justice and right are the foundation of his throne. When Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who were in the dark are thankful for the sunlight. We who live, we who die are grateful for his gift. Thankful for his love. Behold, behold the Lamb of God. All who eat, all who drink shall live. And all who dwell in God shall come to know his glory. Peaceful now, those whose hearts are blessed with understanding. Of the wheat, of the wine, united with his word, and the love we share. Behold the Lamb of God. All who eat, all who drink shall live. And all who dwell in God shall come to know his glory. Gentle one, child of God, join with us at this table. Bless our lives, nourish all who hunger for this feast. Shelter them with peace. Behold, behold the Lamb of God. All who eat, all who drink shall live. And all who dwell in God shall come to know his glory. Lord of all, give us light, deliver us from evil. Make us one, be our shield, make still the winds that blow. Cradle us with love. Behold, behold the Lamb of God. All who eat, all who drink shall live. And all who dwell in God shall come to know his his glory.
Let us pray. May the heavenly nourishment that we have received, O Lord, we pray, transform us into the likeness of your Son, whose radiant splendor you will to make manifest in his glorious transfiguration, who lives and reigns forever and ever. The work on the roof over at St. Bernadette will continue, so daily masses will continue to be here at St. Susanna's until further notice. St. Susanna's is also open for private prayer during the daytime, and the weekend masses are still being held at St. Bernadette. Thursday Adoration and Confession is also going to be here at St. Susanna's during this time. Also want to mention a couple things that I'm involved with this week. You probably noticed it's been up for some months now about the Holy Land Pilgrimage. We are having a meeting. We're probably about close to about 30 people signed up. We have room maybe for, you know, 6 to 10 more, so a few spots available yet as far as I know. But we're having a meeting this Monday, tomorrow, at St. Bernadette's over at Biedenbach Hall at 6:30. So if you have any last minute interest, this is kind of the best time to do it, so you can come to the meeting tomorrow night. For that. Also, the group I'm part of called the Fraternity of Priests are having our monthly healing mass. It'll be down at St. Thomas More in Bethel Park Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. So if you have any interest in that, that'll be Wednesday at 7 at St. Thomas More. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Salve Regina, Mater misericordiae, vita dulcedo, et spes nostra salve. Ad te clamamus, exules filii Eve. ad te suspiramus, gementes et flentes, in ac lacrimarum vale. Ergo, advocata nostra, illos tuos, misericordes oculos, ad nos converte. Et issum benedictum fructum ventris tui, nobis post hoc exilium ostende. O clemens, O pia, O dulcis Virgo Maria. For light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Christ, be our light, shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness, Christ be our light. Shine in your church gathered today. Longing for peace, our world is troubled. Longing for hope, many despair. Your word alone has power to save us. Make us your living voice. Christ be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ be our light. Shine in your church gather today.